has the strength of a god. I saw it with my own eyes.
Your eye deceives you.
Chosen by God since birth to bring deliverance to your people. I anoint you.
Serve the living God.
Thank you. I am your humble servant. Do not abandon me now. Be my strength. Be my strength!
Wait. Do you know the cliffs by the beach, where the path from Gaza meets the sea?
Yes. They are beautiful.
Meet me there tomorrow, first light. Please?
Beginning to wonder if you would show.
I used to play here as a child, walk along the water with my father. It's actually the only reason I chose to come.
Oh, is that so?
Yes.
Why does Jehovah require and deserve our best? How would you answer that? Why is he deserving of it? And yet, why would it be a requirement? The second question, What is our attitude toward doing our best? Which way do you lean? What's your view toward doing your best? The third question. What is our best? How would you answer that? If someone were to ask you, you know, the brother said we should give Jehovah our best, but what is my best? Well, what's your answer? We'll consider that this afternoon. And our final question, what results when we give Jehovah our best? What's the outcome? What are the results? Well, let's look at the first area. Why does Jehovah require and deserve our best? Well, the first thing we need to consider is it's not just from a human standpoint that we're viewing things. We're really viewing them from a spiritual standpoint, from the standpoint of Jehovah God and Jesus Christ. But other than Jehovah and Jesus, let's look at what spirit creatures had to say about this. Let's turn in our Bibles to the book of Revelation. And here in the Revelation, let's look at chapter 4. In Revelation chapter 4, this is really likened to a heavenly vision. And note what spirit creatures are able to say when it comes to why Jehovah requires and deserves our best. Revelation chapter 4, let's look together at verse 11. Now here's what the Bible tells us. You are worthy, Jehovah, even our God, to receive the glory and the honor and the power, because you created all things, and because of your will they existed and were created. So here the Bible tells us that Jehovah is worthy. He's deserving of it. But look at the verse again. There's an interesting thought here. The Bible tells us, yes, Jehovah is worthy. He's worthy to receive the honor and the power. Now, since Jehovah is Almighty God, he's the source of dynamic energy, he's all-powerful, how is it that Jehovah can receive power? Well, the spirit creatures here are just telling us that Jehovah is worthy of being served with all of our power, with all of our strength, with all of our might. So yes, the Bible tells us spirit creatures recognize that Jehovah is worthy to be served with all of our power. Really, with all that we have. That's what the Bible tells us. But why would we as humans want to reason on the matter and say, well, Jehovah, he deserves our best. And yes, he does, in fact, require it. Well, from a human standpoint, we have to look at the examples that Jehovah set out in the Bible. And when we look at the nation of Israel, that was a dedicated nation that was set aside for their service to God. And Jehovah God tells mankind his thinking by the way he dealt with the nation of Israel. Well, sacrifices were a requirement in their service to Jehovah. So in other words, if you were going to serve God and you were an Israelite, you had to offer a sacrifice. It was an integral part of Israelite worship. But we learned something about what Jehovah requires and deserves when we look at the law on fat. Now that was part of the law that was given to the nation of Israel. Yes, I said fat, F-A-T. Did you know there was a law on fat? And it tells us much about our service to Jehovah. Let's turn in our Bibles to the book of Leviticus chapter 3. Here in the Bible, in Leviticus chapter 3, let's turn there together. Leviticus chapter 3, this is referring to many of the sacrifices that the nation of Israel had to offer. But one in particular, Leviticus chapter 3, starting with verse 3, this is explaining whenever a priest would come up and offer sacrifices. Here's what the Bible says in verse 3. And he must present some of the communion sacrifice, an offering made by fire to Jehovah, namely the fat that covers the intestines, even all the fat that is over the intestines, and the two kidneys, and the fat that is upon them, the same as that upon the loins. And as for appendage upon the liver, he will remove it along with the kidneys. So the fat is being singled out. But why? What was so important about the fat of an animal when you had already slaughtered the animal to offer a sacrifice to Jehovah? Look at some of the ensuing verses. Look at verse 16 and 17. And the priest must make them smoke upon the altar as food, an offering made by fire for a restful odor. All the fat belongs to Jehovah. It is a statute to time indefinite for your generations and all your dwelling places. You must not eat any fat or any blood at all. Now that's how serious it was. Jehovah linked fat with blood. It was so important that Jehovah says, now, you're supposed to explain this to your family, no matter where you live. It's a law, it's a statute, to time indefinite. Everyone is supposed to know you don't eat the fat. You could incur the death penalty if you had nerve enough to eat the fat. What did the fat represent? The fat represented the best part of the animal. It represented the choicest part of the animal. Have you ever heard the term a person say, well, I want to live off the fat of the land? Well, what do they mean? Do they mean the thorns and the thistles and the shrubberies? No, they mean the good part. They mean the best part. To Jehovah, the fat represented the best part of the animal. It was the choicest part of the animal. If an Israelite set the fat aside for Jehovah, it was a way of showing him honor. It was a way of showing Jehovah appreciation. It was a way of them saying thank you to Jehovah. It was a way of giving Jehovah their best. They could eat all of the rest of the animal. But the death penalty was installed on anyone that ate the fat. So Jehovah related the quality of their sacrifices to the honor that he received. Does anybody know the governor of Virginia? Or the governor of the state of Maryland? What would you do if someone told you that the governor was going to come to your home to eat? Now, we're not saying that you voted for him or anything like that. We just mean you've been singled out, and they're telling you, well, the governor, we've chosen a citizen, and the governor's going to come to your house, and he's going to eat dinner. And we're going to have television cameras, and we're going to put you in the paper, and we want to know what you serve. Well, what would you serve? What would you serve? Would you serve him some day-old bread? Maybe some leftover lasagna? Or would you kind of go shopping and kind of let some of the friends know, you know, the governor's coming by? Right. Yeah, no, girl, I'm not doing that. I'm just going to go shopping because, you know, the governor's coming by. You know how the brother said, yeah, let me run on up here to the store because, oh, he's not coming by your house? But what would you serve the governor? Well, that was an issue that Jehovah had with the nation of Israel. Now, for the young people here, you might say, well, I don't really, really don't have a house and not really interested in the governor. But for the young people here, if someone told you that one of these music moguls were going to come by your home, or some of these young men you see pumped up on the magazines, some of these young women that you see that, well, you know you're a witness, but you really kind of like them. You kind of admire them. What would you do if you knew that they were coming to your house? What would you want your parents to fix? You want your parents to go ahead and just kind of give them leftovers? Maybe day-old bread? Well, think about this. Jehovah viewed everything that the nation of Israel did as a way of showing him honor, as a way of showing him appreciation, as a way of showing him respect. Now, he's deserving because with the nation of Israel, he says, well, I've given you all that you have. All that you have is from me. And if you set the fat aside for me, that shows me honor. That shows thankfulness. That shows appreciation. But more was involved. Let's turn to Malachi chapter 1. Let's turn over to the book of Malachi chapter 1. And here in the Bible, it tells us that more is involved. When we give Jehovah our best, it's evidence of how we feel about him. In Malachi chapter 1, we want to start reading at verse 6, and we'll get the import of what it's saying. Jehovah said, a son, for his part, honors a father. So we're talking about honor. And a servant, his grandmaster. So if I am a father, where is the honor to me? And if I am a grandmaster, where is the fear of me? Jehovah of armies has said to you, O priests who are despising my name. Now, why would Jehovah talk to the priests in this way? Well, look at what they were doing. The latter part of verse 6. And you have said, in what way have we despised your name? By presenting upon my altar polluted bread. And you have said, in what way have we polluted you? By your saying, the table of Jehovah is something to be despised. And when you present a blind animal for sacrificing, it is nothing bad. And when you present a lame animal or a sick one, it is nothing bad. Bring it near, please, to your governor. Will he find pleasure in you? Or will he receive you kindly? Jehovah of armies had said. Do you see the point? Jehovah said that you're not showing honor to me. You're actually despising me. They said, well, how are we doing that? He said, you're giving me polluted bread. When you offer a sacrifice, you're giving me a lame animal. He said, you wouldn't give that to your governor. Then why would you offer it to me? You see, Jehovah has always required that his servants give him the best. That's always been a requirement from Jehovah. Now, if we had to offer up animals, just to make sure we understand what Malachi is telling the nation of Israel, suppose we had to offer up animals. Maybe once a month you had a herd of sheep, and once a month you had to kill one of your sheep and offer it as a sacrifice to Jehovah. Well, which one would you kill? Would you kill the one that he's obviously blind? He's been walking in the walls and walking, almost walking off cliffs. Well, obviously, you might be moved to kill that one. Jehovah said, don't give me that one. He said, bring me your best. Because everything Jehovah did for the nation of Israel, it was a way of them showing him honor. It was a way of them showing Jehovah that we honor you. We don't despise you. Now, the actual reference that Malachi was referring to, it was in the law that we read in Leviticus. In fact, let's go back to Leviticus, but this time, let's read Leviticus chapter 22. And all of this lays a good foundation for us to see that Jehovah requires and he deserves our best. Let's go back to Leviticus chapter 22 this time. Leviticus chapter 22, and now let's start reading at verse 22. No case of blindness or fracture or having a cut or wart or scabbiness or ringworm, none of these must you present to Jehovah, and no offering made by fire from them must you put upon the altar for Jehovah. As for a bull or a sheep having a member too long or too short, you may make it a voluntary offering. But for a vow, it will not be accepted with approval. Well, we learn quite a bit here. This is the reference that Malachi was referring to. If an Israelite were going to make an offering, it couldn't have a defect. It couldn't be blind. It couldn't even have a cut or a wart or a scab. Well, what do we learn here? How would an Israelite know whether or not one of their animals had a cut or a ringworm? How would they know whether it had a scab? How would they know? This tells us that they couldn't be casual in offering sacrifices to Jehovah. They couldn't just walk in the backyard and just casually grab any animal and come and offer it to Jehovah. No, they had to examine the animal. They had to look over it daily. They had to make sure that what they're getting ready to offer to Jehovah was their best. Well, that tells us today that we can't be casual in our service to Jehovah. You know, we don't just wake up one day and say, you know, I'm going to go and give Jehovah my best. It doesn't work that way. As humans, we're selfish by nature. We come out of the womb taking and wanting. We probably got more whippings because we didn't share it than anything else. From birth, we're selfish. So we're not going to automatically just serve Jehovah the proper way. Are there any newborn babies here in this congregation? Now, when's the last time you've seen a newborn baby? Maybe just a couple months old. When's the last time you've seen a newborn baby laying in the crib about 2 in the morning, wet and hungry? When's the last time you seen a newborn baby say, well, you know, my father had a hard day. He's tired. And I heard him discussing with my mother some things. His voice didn't even sound the same. And my mother, she didn't even speak to me the way she normally did. So I can tell she's not feeling well. So I'm just going to lay here and till I hear them stirring around, then I'll let them know that I need to be changed. When's the last time you known a newborn baby to do that? No, that baby starts yelling, you better come in here and see about me. See, it's selfish from birth. You know, some mothers have been known to lose their teeth because the baby extracts all the calcium out of their body. We come out of the womb that way. You're not going to automatically give Jehovah your best. It doesn't work that way. The Bible says the only way we're going to give Jehovah our best, we're going to have to think about it. The Bible says we want to serve Jehovah with our power of reason. To think about it. To reason on it. And look for ways. We can't be casual, but look for ways and purposely look for opportunities to show Jehovah that we honor him, that we love him, we appreciate him, and we feel that he is worthy of our service. Well, today we don't offer up animal sacrifices. And many of us, we say, well, thank God for that. We don't have to kill animals. But we do offer a sacrifice. And note what the Bible tells us in the book of Romans chapter 12. Here in the Bible in Romans chapter 12, we really want to draw your attention to verse 1. What we're trying to see is, how is it that we could say we offer sacrifices today as Christians? In Romans chapter 12 and verse 1. Again, here's what the Bible tells us. Consequently, I entreat you by the compassions of God, brothers, to present your bodies a sacrifice, living, holy, acceptable to God, a sacred service, notice this, with your power of reason. So here the Bible tells us that as Christians, we do offer a sacrifice. Jehovah says, I want you, not animals, but I want you. I want you while you're alive. You notice the Bible says you offer a sacrifice, it has to be living. Why anyone's willing to offer their body once they're dead? You hear people say, well, when I die, I want to leave off of my body for science and research. Jehovah says, no, I don't want you when you're dead. He says, I want you living, and it has to be a holy and acceptable sacrifice. Many people today say, well, it's hard to be holy in this day and age. God says, you must be holy because I am holy. And then the Bible tells us that we're going to have to reason on it. We're going to have to think about it. Why does Jehovah require and deserve our best? Why he's given us everything that we have. Marketing, merchandising, and salespeople may want you to fool yourself and to think that you earned it, that you worked hard for it, but you only have it by means of Jehovah. He's given us everything that we have. Why does Jehovah require it? It's a way that we can show him honor. It's a way that we can demonstrate our appreciation for him. And as dedicated Christian servants of God, Jehovah requires that we give him the best that we have. Our sacrifice today is our service to Jehovah. It's us. Do we bypass the things that we want to do in order to put our service to Jehovah first? Yes, Jehovah not only deserves it, but he requires it. And we could say Jehovah not only requires it, but he deserves our best. And we learn much from the sacrifices of the nation of Israel and the law on fat. Remember, it represented the best part of the animal, the choice part of the lamb. And of course, we can't be casual in offering sacrifices to Jehovah. It's going to take forethought. It's going to take examination. Give Jehovah your best. Let's look at our second area. We said we were going to examine four areas. Let's look at the second area. Now, the first area is, why does Jehovah require and deserve our best? Now, the second area, what is our attitude toward doing our best? What's your attitude? Now, the word attitude, that's really an interesting word. Now, to help you to appreciate how interesting this word is, usually when I start this particular talk, I have to focus on two individuals. I have to focus on two individuals because it really helps us to illustrate a point. Now, this question is, what is our attitude toward doing our best? But let me tell you about this word attitude. How many of us have heard of the word longitude? Just kind of raise your hand if you heard of longitude. Good. That's the vast majority of us. Do you know that the word longitude has reference to a position here on this earth? There's a little town in England, Greenwich, England, that's zero longitude on this earth. So if someone wanted to find you, they could actually find you in reference to Greenwich, England. Either you're 45 degrees to the east or 45 degrees to the west of Greenwich, England. They would know your exact position on this earth because of your longitude. They know your position. Now, how many in our audience, perhaps by a show of hands, have heard of the word latitude? Just kind of raise your hand. Okay, we not all only went to the same school, we all graduated. Good. Do you know the word latitude, like longitude, it has reference to a position here on this earth? The equator is zero latitude. So if someone wanted to find you, they'd know exactly where you are on this earth. They'd know your position based on where you are in reference to the equator. Or zero latitude. Maybe you'd be 45 degrees to the north or 45 degrees to the south, but they know your position. They know exactly where you are. That's reference to a position. Now, how many in our audience, yes, by a show of hands, have heard of the word attitude? Okay, you're catching on. You know, like longitude and like latitude, the word attitude has reference to a position. No, not a physical position. It has reference to a mental posture, a mental position that we assume sometime and we don't give it any thought. Now that is an attitude. It's a mental posture. We assume it sometime and we haven't thought about it. Least of all, does our thinking agree with God's? Now you have heard of longitude and you've heard of latitude. But you'll lose your life because of your attitude. You'll lose your life because of your view or your attitude toward doing your best. You see, when I start to talk, some are sitting in a certain position. Now, normally, as humans, we usually adjust our position. That's just natural. We adjust our position. If a person doesn't adjust their position, what do we normally think? See how the brother's looking at me right now? What do we normally think? We normally think, well, something might be wrong. What would you say if I just came here and just stood like this and just gave the talk for about an hour and I just stood like this? You say, something's wrong with the brother. Go get him down. No, we normally expect people to adjust their position. Now, if you assume a certain mental posture or attitude and you're not willing to adjust your position, guess what? Something's wrong with you. Because we normally make adjustments. Now, when I started, the young man right here in this nice beige suit, yeah, I was looking at you. He's smiling now. Come on, man. No, you know, when I actually started to talk, he was kind of leaning over to the right. He was kind of crowding you out a little bit, wasn't he? He just naturally adjusts his position. He just settled down, and now he's kind of leaning over to the left. My sister right here, that's a blue jean outfit. Okay. She said, now, no, he didn't. Yeah. Oh, she's adjusted her position several times. In fact, if she were to sit there and didn't move, I would think something's wrong with her. But she's adjusted her posture. She's adjusted her position. Now, what's your attitude toward doing your best? Now, Oprah Winfrey may not touch on it. Judge Judy and Judge Roy Brown, Dr. Field, they may not touch on it. Now, some of the young rap moguls in the music industry, they may not touch on it. And if you have a certain attitude toward doing your best, is it in harmony with the position or the posture that God wants you to have? As humans, we will assume a certain mental posture and we don't give it any thought. You ever heard someone make a disparaging comment about a person of another race? You ever heard someone say, well, you know how they are. You better be careful. That's not God's view. Where did you get that from? See, we assume a position and we didn't even think about it. That's not even God's view. But we'll take a certain posture. And we may say, no man, no body of man, no organization of man is going to make me change. Well, something's wrong. And it'll cost you your life. When we talk about examining our service to Jehovah, we're asking the question, what is your attitude toward doing your best? Which way do you lean? What's your view? What's your posture when it comes to doing your best? Well, know what the Bible tells us. Philippians chapter 2. Since this is so serious, it involves our life, we're happy that Jehovah did not leave us on our own. In Philippians chapter 2, here's what the Bible has to say. Philippians chapter 2, we want to start reading at verse 5, but let's just hold on to the first word in that verse. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 5, the Bible says, keep, well, we need to stop right there. Because that implies work. You know how hard it is to keep $10? See, right there, the Bible said, keep, well, that tells, now that's going to take some work. That's going to take effort. It's hard to keep $5 nowadays. You ever had $10 and just say, well, I'm going to keep this the entire month? You better not go outside. You better not get on the internet. You better not have children. It's hard to keep $10. So the Bible says, now look at verse 5, keep this mental attitude, there's our word, in you that was also in Christ Jesus. What was his view? Which way did he lean? Who, although he was existing in God's form, gave no consideration to a seizure, namely, that he should be equal to God. So he never tried to seize the position of Jehovah, although he was existing in the form of a spirit creature. His attitude, he never tried to be equal to God. Verse 7, no. But he emptied himself and took a slave's form, and came to be in the likeness of men. More than that, when he found himself in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient as far as death. Yes, death on a torture stake. Well, that's the attitude we want to have. That's the mental posture or the position that we want to have. The Bible says we should keep the same attitude that Jesus Christ had. Well, right away, humility will be involved. Many times we'll have to humble ourselves just to be willing to give Jehovah all that we have. Is that your attitude toward doing your best? Let's go back and look at the verse again, though. Verse 6 tells us that although he was existing in God's form, he gave no consideration to a seizure, namely that he should be equal to God. No, but he emptied himself. Now, how did Jesus empty himself? The Bible says he emptied himself. How did he do that? Well, let's stop and think about it. Where was Jesus before he came to the earth? The Bible tells us, it helps us to appreciate that for eons, for thousands of years, it was just Jehovah and Jesus. Just those two. It was just Jehovah and it was Jesus. Why? What a position he had. It was just Jehovah and it was Jesus. We don't know for how long they were together, but what a close relationship they had. When Jehovah started to create things, he used Jesus to create them. What a mighty position he had. He was the firstborn of all creation, the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us that there are ranks in heaven, and Jesus had the highest rank. He was known as the Word or the Logos. What a position of royalty and dignity and authority that Jesus had when he was in heaven. You know, he gave all that up. You know, he emptied himself. When he came to the earth, he was in the womb of an imperfect woman. You know, he had to learn how to walk and to talk. Once he learned how to walk and talk, you know, he had to be obedient to imperfect parents. And when he was on the earth, did people respect him for his dignity and his position? No, they spit on him. They beat him. He died an accursed criminal on a torture stake. Oh, he emptied himself. He gave all of that up. Now, why? What was his attitude? Remember, Jesus said, Jehovah, I'm just here to do your will. To do your will, I have delight. He said, it's within my inward parts. Now, that's the attitude the Bible tells us that we should have. When it comes to giving Jehovah our best, what is our attitude? What's our position? Or which way do we lean? Do we do it simply because it's Jehovah's will? Do we do it out of humility? That's my delight. Jesus said, it's within me. That's who I am. It's within my ends. If they're going to get recognition or accolades for it, they can stand up on a pedestal and they say, you see him there? He's the best. As long as they can win a contest, many don't mind giving their best. Maybe if someone's going to read the name off, put them on a list of elders or ministerial servants, maybe view them as a pioneer, Bethelite or missionary, if they can get that recognition, well, okay, now you're talking. But just to give Jehovah my best, just for the sake of giving my best, what is that all about? Bible says you have to do that with your power of reason. You got to think about that, because we're selfish by nature. The world is not going to teach you that. And so our attitude, our posture of giving Jehovah our best, it should be one of humility. Look at the verse again. It tells us something that Jesus did. Verse 7, it says, no, but he emptied himself and took a slave's form and came to be in the likeness of men. More than that, when he found himself in fashion as a man, he humbled himself. You know, Jehovah can't use proud people. It takes humility to give Jehovah your best. And isn't it loving of Jehovah to allow us to humble ourselves? See, Jesus humbled himself. The Bible tells us, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Jehovah said, you don't want me to humble you. See, if I have to humble you, might not be anything left. Jehovah says, I'm going to allow you to humble yourself. Well, that's the attitude. That's the posture. That's the mental position in which we serve Jehovah. Now, the sons of Ephraim, they were known as a tribe for something, similar to the Benjaminites. Now, the Benjaminites, they were known with a sling. You couldn't beat a Benjaminite with a sling. You know, researchers say they were accurate up to 30 to 50 yards with a sling. They could put a rock and a sling and hit you 30 to 50 yards away. If you hit a Benjaminite and run, you better turn a corner. I mean, that's how good they were with a sling. The Benjaminites. Now, the sons of Ephraim, they were different. They were skilled with the bow and arrow. You couldn't beat them with a bow and arrow. They never missed. The Benjaminites might have been good with a sling, but the Ephraimites, you couldn't beat them with a bow and arrow. But there was a problem. Now turn with me in your Bible to the 79th Psalm. Now here in our Bible, the Psalm, let's make it the 78th Psalm rather. Psalm 78, here's what the Bible tells us about the sons of Ephraim. Here in the 78th Psalm, look at verse 9. The Bible highlights something for us. The sons of Ephraim, though armed shooters of the bow, retreated in the day of fight. Now, you couldn't beat them as long as it was a contest. If they were going to win something, they'd stand up there. They didn't miss. They came through every time. But they retreated in the day of battle. When they got in the heat of the battle, they ran. You know, that's the tendency of mankind today. Now, we can get recognition or accolades. I'm there. I'm there to win the contest. I'll give you my best. But when we get in the heat of the battle, when we get in these last days of this dying and wicked system, when it becomes hard on us, when it's a real fight, some will run every time. They don't have the same view of giving God their best. They don't have the same attitude. They'll be quick to tell you, well, see, the economy is bad, and we have to look out for ourselves, and it's our children, Now, if they're going to win a contest, they'll be there to give their best. But the attitude that Jesus had when he was in the heat of the battle, when he was being reviled, when he was being spit on, he stayed the course of fire. He gave Jehovah his best. Is that what we're willing to do? Which way do you lean? What's your posture? When we have decisions to make in life, how do we make them? Do we make them based on what's best for us? Or is it our general attitude or view that let's humble ourselves? Let's take a slave's form while we're in fashion as men and women. Is it within us like Jesus? Jehovah, just to do your will. That's my delight. That's all I want to do. Whether I get recognition for it or not, I want to give you my best. Or are we only moved to do so to be viewed by man, to get recognition by man, to be viewed better than others? Or do we have the attitude or view of Jesus Christ? He said, to do your will is my delight, and your law is within my inward parts. Jesus said, it is a part of me. The Bible says we have to keep it. We have to work at that attitude. We have to work at that view. If that hasn't formally been our view, well, maybe we can make some adjustments. If we need to look at our service and examine our service to Jehovah, well, now's the time to be willing to make the adjustments, to think about it. Don't assume a certain posture toward our service to God without giving it thought. But serve Jehovah with your power of reason. Let's look at our third area. Then we ask the question, what is our best? Now, we've discussed that Jehovah requires and he deserves our best. And he certainly does, as our Heavenly Father, loving God. And we've been helped to appreciate that. What is the attitude that we should have in serving Jehovah and giving our best? Well, it's that of Jesus Christ, to be humble, to be willing to do all that we can, to make it a part of us. Well, now the question is, what is our best? What would you say is your best? You know, Jehovah helps us to appreciate that in no uncertain terms. Again, it's so important. It's a way of demonstrating our honor and our appreciation to him that Jehovah really pointed this out. But the only people that find this are those that are determined to give Jehovah their best. Now, it's illustrated for us over and over again in the Bible. But let's go back and look at an illustration that's used in the Bible. It was a parable. It's something that Jesus said. It didn't actually happen. Now, keep that in mind. It didn't even really happen. It was just an illustration. It was just a parable. But in the illustration, Jesus helps us to get Jehovah God's thought. He helps us to understand God's view. Now, this is the illustration. It's a famous one. It's the one about the prodigal son. Now, the word prodigal in the actual scriptures is not even in the Bible. It's just in the running heads of some Bible. But the prodigal son was a wasteful son. Prodigal, wasteful. He squandered his inheritance. So he told his father, I want all that I have coming to me. I want it now. He took his inheritance, and he went and he wasted it. He fell on hard times. Now, times were so bad, he was herding swine. The food that he had, he was almost like he was eating the food that pigs and swine were eating. Well, the Bible says that he came to his senses. So now he wanted to go back to his father's house. Well, let's look at it from the father's view. You know, the father missed his son. He missed him very bad. And probably many times in this little home and the walkway and the approach to the home, probably many times the father walked out there and just thinking about his son, just out walking, and he would look and see a figure and say, "I think that's my boy," and it wouldn't be his son. And imagine how let down he was. And he'd look over another day and he'd say, Is that my son? And no, it wouldn't be his son. Probably did this quite often. Missed his son. Well, one day, do you remember what happened? One day, the father is out there. And he probably looked up and he said, "I think that's my boy. I think that's my son." You have that picture? Because Jesus is telling us something about Jehovah. Let's turn in our Bibles to Luke chapter 15. Here in the Bible book of Luke, Luke gave a lot of details in all of his accounts. In Luke chapter 15, we're going to pick up this narrative, and starting there at verse 21. The son came back home. Now he's with his father. Then the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy of being called your son. Make me as one of your hired men." But the father said to his slaves, here's the point. But the father said to his slaves, "Quick, bring out a robe, the best one." That's significant. "And clothe him with it, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet." Do you notice what the father said? He's so happy that his son is back. "My son has come home." This didn't happen. Jesus used it in an illustration. He's really helping us to see Jehovah's view on matters. So the father tells his servants in verse 22, he said, "Quick, bring out a robe, the best one." Now in original Greek language, you know what word is here instead of "the best one"? And it helps us to see Jehovah's view, what our best actually is. What word do you think is there? He said, "Bring out a robe, the best one." He said, "Bring out a robe, the first one." You got to keep that in mind. The first one. So this tells us that our best is what we have first. Now, for those of us that don't fully appreciate that, Jehovah always gives his best. And what did he give? He gave his firstborn son. He gave his best one. It should be no doubt in our mind what our best is. There are other angels. There are other spirit creatures. But there could be no greater sacrifice than the first one. His firstborn son. And Jehovah always gives his best. He gave us his firstborn. Do you see what Jesus is telling us here? Our best is what we have first. Now, in human terms, that's a little hard for us to comprehend. Many times, those of us that have Bible studies, we have Bible students that are making progress, and we invite them to the meetings, and they're a little hesitant about coming, and sometimes they're hesitant because they legitimately will tell us, "Well, I don't have anything to wear." And we appreciate that because they're trying to show respect for Jehovah's house of worship and for our teaching process in the meetings. So over and over, they say, "Well, I would come, but I don't really have anything to wear." Well, what do we move to say sometimes, especially if they're about our same size? What do we move to say? "Well, you know, I think I have a suit that you can wear that'll fit you." Or we tell the girl, "You know, I think we're about to say, I think I have a dress that you could fit. Would you give them your best one? Would you give them your best suit? Or your best dress?" Probably take the best suit and hide it down in the basement somewhere. So our best is what we have first. That means it's your energy. It's your time. It's all of your strength. No, your boss wants your best. And now any of your surplus that you can give, come here and maybe give it to Jehovah, he doesn't mind that, but your boss wants your best. Jehovah told the men of Israel, "When you come to my house, you bring me a gift." Now, Visa and Macy's and MasterCard, they want your best. They want you what you have first, and anything left, then you can take that to the kingdom hall and put it in the box. But they want your best. So what is our best? It's what we have first. It's our resources. It's our time. It's our strength. It's our energy. It's our stamina. It's our service to Jehovah. It's what we have first. Our best is not necessarily indicating that we will wipe ourselves out to give Jehovah our best. He's not that type of God. Would Jehovah require every drop from us? Is that what we're saying? Is he requiring every piece of strength that we can muster? Would you run an engine at top speed just because it can go top speed? Would that be reasonable? In fact, manufacturers and researchers tell us to get the best performance, just run an engine at a steady pace. You'll get the best performance. Run a machine at a steady pace, and you'll get longevity. So our best, yes, it's what we have first, our strength, our time, and our energy. But make no mistake about it, Jehovah's not requiring every drop. That's not the type of God that we serve. You know, years ago, sisters were not allowed to give talks in the theocratic ministry school. They could be present and they could benefit from the instruction, but they weren't allowed to be on the theocratic ministry school. You know, it wasn't until 1958 that sisters actually were allowed to join the school. They made the announcement in 57. 1958, sisters were on the theocratic ministry school. Now, you know, in the 30s, the 20s, the 30s, and the 40s, sisters came to meetings and they had to kind of suffer through it. And certainly when the theocratic ministry school was started in the 40s, you know, the sisters would sit there and the brothers wouldn't be prepared. They'd kind of stumble through the talks. And the sisters would say, oh, just let us get up there. We'd show them how to do it. Oh, we could just get up there and give some talks, girl. They'd look down at each other. He's not prepared, but if we could do it, you know what we would do. Well, in 1958, the sisters were allowed to join the school. And what happened? Would you believe some show up at the Kingdom Hall not even prepared for their talks? At least call your householder. We have cell phones nowadays. You see, they come in the hall, and first thing they do, we got to go to the back. Well, you kind of had all week, at least. Maybe sometime you have 3 weeks in advance. See, your boss wants your best. But do we give Jehovah what we have first? Have we taken it for granted? Our best is what we have first. It's our time. It's our strength. It's all of the resources that we have. And sometimes we'll have to serve God with our power of reason because we're selfish by nature. We're going to think about it. Why, if we knew the privilege that it was to be a part of the theocratic ministry school. Theocratic, that means ruled by God. It's the greatest school on the earth. And for brothers to have the privilege to give special instruction. Talk about a speech quality that we need in our ministry. To give instruction, the instruction talk, or highlights from the Bible reading. What a privilege to be on the theocratic ministry school and to have a major part in teaching. But are we prepared? Have we given it our all? Are we putting Jehovah first? What is our best? It's to put Jehovah first. It's what we have first. It may be our time. It may be our strength. It may be what little bit of strength and energy and stamina we have. But put Jehovah first. He said, bring out a robe, the best one, the first one. And yes, Jehovah gave his firstborn son. What is our best? Our best is whole-souled service. That's how we know we're putting Jehovah first. Turn with me in the Bible to the book of Mark, chapter 12, as we really examine what is our best. In Mark, chapter 12, let's read this particular account starting at verse 28. They were trying to question Jesus. They were asking him a question. In Mark, chapter 12, and verse 28, now, one of the scribes that had come up and heard them disputing, knowing that he had answered them in a fine way, asked him, which commandment is first of all? Jesus answered, the first is, hear, O Israel, Jehovah our God is one Jehovah. And you must love Jehovah your God with your whole heart and with your whole soul and with your whole mind and with your whole strength. Now that's interesting. Jesus said that you must serve Jehovah with your whole heart, your whole mind, your whole soul, and your whole strength. Now we teach in Bible studies that the soul is you. It is your heart. It is your mind. It is your strength. It's all of you and everything that you purport to be. The soul is you. Why then would Jesus include all of these other factors if the soul is you? It's because Jesus, being a teacher, he knew that as humans, unless we put forth a deliberate effort to serve Jehovah with our whole soul, we might only serve him with part of it. Now, in our Bible encyclopedia, Insight on the Scriptures, the faithful and discreet slave, they illustrate it this way. A person can sell their soul into slavery. Maybe you have a debt, you owe a brother $10,000, and the brother say, well, I know you can't pay me, so you work for me. You work for me, you can pay it off. That a deal? Yes, I'll be your slave. Now you sold your soul into slavery. Now he explains to you the job. What is the work that you have to do? You're going to work out in the field. Rain, sleet, and snow, summertime, but you got to work out in the field. But you begin to realize that as you work out in the field, it doesn't even take all of your strength. It doesn't even take all of your heart. And you can do this job and your mind doesn't have to be in it. Now you sold your soul into slavery. But are you serving him whole soul? No, you realize it. This doesn't take 100%. Well, all Satan wants is a little bit. Then he has the victory. He only wants a little bit. If he can get us to give Jehovah only part of our strength, only some of it, then he has the victory. Now, there's a brother who comes into meetings. He sits about right over here. It's about right there. He comes into the meetings, and about 15, 20 minutes into the meeting, if you look over there at him, you see his head drop. It's hard for him to bear up. He's going to sleep. Now, all of us, we're tired occasionally, and it's kind of hard for us to bear up, but this happens every meeting. He goes to sleep every meeting. They're going to count him because he's in attendance, and brothers don't take the count until about 20 minutes into the meeting, so they're going to count him because he's here in attendance. And we don't mean the brother who just occasionally goes to sleep, but every meeting he goes to sleep. It's so bad, the young ones, they're in the back taking bets when he's going to go to sleep. He's about right there. And every meeting, he goes to sleep. Is he serving Jehovah whole soul? Now, right away, you say, but we don't know that, brother. We don't know all he had to go through and what he had to do throughout that day and how early he had to get up in the morning and how hard he's trying to serve Jehovah. And that's true. We don't know him. But what's it going to cost him? What's it going to cost him to stay up, to stay alert, to be alert at the meeting? Is it going to take more of his mind? Yes, it is. Going to take more of his heart? It's going to take more of his strength. Unless he puts forth a deliberate effort to stay up during the meeting, he might be serving Jehovah, not with his whole soul, but only with part of it. That's what the master was illustrating. Now, a sister, she makes all the meetings. She comes in and she sits about right over there, and she's early. The brothers might as well give her a key because she beats the brothers here. She's regular in the field ministry. And she makes every meeting. And during the meeting, the brothers are going to count her too because she's in attendance and she makes every meeting. Now, she doesn't really raise her hand and give any comments. She doesn't say anything to anybody prior to the meeting or after. No expressions of faith, no words of encouragement, doesn't pull anybody to the side. She just attends the meetings, and after the meeting, she collects her things and off she goes. Now, she might stop at the back and tell the brother, magazines, please. But that's about it, and then off she goes. Now, here's the question. Is she serving Jehovah with her whole soul? Now, right away, you say, no, we got you, brother. We got you, brother. Because, see, we don't know what all she went through. You know, we bring up, you know, we don't know her childhood, and the things she went through in her childhood, and how hard life has been on her. And that's true. We don't know her. But what's it going to cost her? What's it going to cost her to raise her hand and give an expression of faith? What's it going to cost her to say something encouraging, upbuilding to one of the brothers or the sisters? Is it going to take more of her mind? Yes, it is. Our best is whole-souled service. It has to cost us. We should feel it. David said there could be no sacrifice without a sacrifice. He said, when I serve my God, I want it to cost me. I want to feel it. Don't give me the feel. He said, I'll buy it. The man said, well, you don't have to buy. You can take the field. David said, no, It has to hurt me. It has to cost me. Whole-souled service. It's going to take our heart. It's going to take our mind. It's going to take our strength. If you're coasting along, something could be wrong in our service to Jehovah. Now, there's a family. They come in, and they kind of sit towards the back there. It's the family of four or five, maybe three, and they kind of come in, and they sit towards the back there because they usually come in late. And the brothers are going to count them, too, because they don't take the count maybe 10, 15, 20 minutes into the meeting. That's when they make the count, and that family, they're usually there then. But they usually sit back there in the back there. They're the ones kind of hard on your knees, disturbing the teaching process as they come in. And every meeting, they're late. Now, we don't mean the ones that from time to time they're late. Now, that's going to happen to all of us. But we mean the family, they are habitually late. In fact, when you're on your way to the meeting, you see them. You say, oh, we're late. When you ride down the street, you see them at the light. You're like, we're late. You see, well, that's the family we're talking about. Okay. All right, now. Here's the question. Are they serving Jehovah with their whole soul? Well, again, you might say, well, we don't know what all it takes for them. You get to the meetings. Brother's working two jobs. Sister's working a job and a half. Got to round up the kids. And we meet the kids on the corner, on the bus stop. They don't even go home. And that's what the family has to do. See, we don't really know that family. We don't know all that they have to go through. And that's true. We don't know. But what's it going to cost them? What's it going to take for that family to make it here to the meeting on time? Is it going to take more of their heart? Yes, it is. It's going to take more of their mind? They got to think about it? Of course it is. It's going to take more of their strength? Yes. But unless that family puts forth a deliberate effort to make it to the meeting on time, they might serve Jehovah, not with their whole soul, but only with part of it. Our best is whole-souled service. We must give it our all. Our power of reason, our strength, put our heart in it. That's our best. Now, it'd be good to point out that our best is not always what we would like to do. But it's what we can do, because many of our long timers, you've been serving Jehovah for years, and you just can't do what you used to do. You can't do what you want to do. Well, isn't it loving that Jehovah determines what our best is? He determines whole soul service and not anyone else. It's not the form of worship. Whether we're in a full-time service or not, that doesn't necessarily determine our best. Jehovah makes that determination. So we humble ourselves. We serve Jehovah with our whole soul. We do all that we can to give Jehovah our best. What is our best? It's what we have first. It's whole-souled service to Jehovah. Doing our best involves not so much as our circumstances, but it's our attitude. Why are we doing it? Not what we're doing, but why we're doing it. That helps us to determine our best. Let's look at our fourth and our final point. What results when we give Jehovah our best? What's the outcome? We've learned Jehovah requires and deserves it. We've talked about our attitude toward doing our best. And we've considered here briefly what is our best. Now, what results when we give Jehovah our best? Well, let's turn in our Bibles to the book of Numbers. The book of Numbers, and we want to look at Numbers chapter 23. Now, these are the results of individuals serving Jehovah with their best. Now, this was a trialsome time for the nation of Israel. During the time of a man named Balaam and Balak, they were trying to curse the nation of Israel. And every time they tried to curse the nation, Jehovah would make it turn out into a blessing. And again, they would try to curse the nation, and Jehovah would turn it out into a blessing. And so they were wondering, what is going on? How is it that it's always a blessing? Well, in Numbers chapter 23, let's look at verse 23. Here's what the Bible tells us. For there is no unlucky spell against Jacob, nor any divination against Israel. At this time, may it be said respecting Jacob and Israel, what has God worked out. Look what God has done. Well, the results of people giving their best, all of the praise, all of the honor goes to Jehovah. People look up and say, what has God worked out? Look at we ourselves. Now, many of us, we wake up in the morning, we're happy to see ourselves in the mirror, and we say, look what God has done. I'm still alive. What has God worked out? Many of us can tell stories of where we used to be, where we could be if we were still alive. But because we made a decision to serve Jehovah, and now because we strive to serve Jehovah and give him our best, the praise and the honor goes to Jehovah. People look up and say, look what God has done. So when we give Jehovah our best, when we do all that we can in our service to Jehovah, all of the praise, all of the honor, remember, all of the glory goes to Jehovah. Remember, Moses, he wanted to free the nation of Israel, but he didn't understand. He didn't understand that it's what God works out. Now, the Bible tells that Moses was powerful in both word and deed. Remember that? But he saw an Egyptian mistreating an Israelite. He went over and killed the man. Now, with that temperament, with the way he was conducting himself, if he had tried to free the nation of Israel at that time, can you imagine how many Israelites he would have killed out there in the wilderness? Jehovah says, well, now you're powerful in word and deed. You may have some abilities, but you don't have the qualities. Jehovah says, let me work it out. He says, I'm going to free the people. But when I free the people, I'm going to get the glory. Not Moses. Jehovah says, let me work it out. And that's what Jehovah has to do with us. There's things that we see we don't like. We want to stop giving Jehovah our best. We want to say something about it. Jehovah says, let me work it out. Just stay in my hands. Let me work it out. And people will say, look what God has done. Now with Moses, you know, 40 years he was out there in that wilderness. 40 years, a long time to be out in the wilderness. He was herding sheep. Remember, he was powerful in word and deed. But Jehovah says, you don't have the qualities. You're not ready. So what did Jehovah do with Moses? It's the same thing he does with us. We feel it sometimes. By the time he got through with Moses, Moses said, can Aaron go with me? Because I can't talk. Jehovah said, now you're ready. Yeah, I want you to go and see Pharaoh. Yeah, but can Aaron go? Because I can't talk. Jehovah said, now you're ready. And that's the way it is with us. Jehovah says, oh, I'm going to free the people. You don't have to worry about that. But when I free the people, I'm going to get the glory. So stay in Jehovah's hands. Allow Jehovah to mold us. We may need discipline. We may need counsel and encouragement. We may need self-control. There are going to be adjustments that we need to make in our attitude, in our posture. Let Jehovah work it out. Jehovah says, I'm going to get the glory. You know, of the thousands of restaurants in New York City, there are literally thousands of restaurants in New York City. You know, they did a survey one year, and they named the top 15 restaurants of the five boroughs in New York City. Of the thousands, they narrowed it down to the top 15. And of the top 15 restaurants in New York City, guess what? There was only one in Brooklyn. You know which one it was? When they listed the address in the newspaper, you know what the address was? 124 Columbia Heights, Brooklyn, New York. It was the dining room in Brooklyn. The brothers didn't know what was going on because the brothers in the lobby, they started getting calls. People say, yeah, I want to get a reservation at this restaurant. One brother worked at this. He said, a man called, yeah, I need a reservation for four at the restaurant. The brother said, well, now, what congregation are you with? The man said, congregation? He said, yeah, who's your presiding officer? He said, oh, I'm off probation. He thought it meant, he said, who is your PO? He thought he meant probation officer. But stop and think about that. Out of the thousands of restaurants in New York City, all of those restaurants in Brooklyn, it was the dining room at Bethel that had to pass surprise inspections for 5 years straight without one serious violation. Now, the brothers working in the dining room, they just men that just showed up and said, well, I just, to do your will, Jehovah. I don't know anything about all this, but I'm just here to do your will. And Jehovah says, oh, I'm going to get the glory. The brothers there, they just presented themselves to do God's will. And Jehovah says, let me work it out. And all of the praise, all of the honor, and all of the glory goes to Jehovah. You see, what Satan wants to do, he wants to wrap us up in a garment of flesh. The world is so fleshly today. Everything you see is so fleshly. He wants to wrap us up in a garment of flesh. He wants to encase your heart in steel. He doesn't want us to have any feelings. Just go with the flesh. Don't have feelings for people. And he wants to march us around in the ranks of the living dead. That's what Satan wants to do. He doesn't want us to be concerned about Jehovah and our service to him. Least of all, giving Jehovah our best. And sure, we have hard times. And sure, we have trouble. Trouble is our lot. We live at the end of a dying and a wicked system of things. And Jehovah says, those honoring me, in spite of their trials and tribulation, Jehovah says, I will honor them. And Jehovah says, if you don't honor me, I won't honor you either. So what should we do? We should give Jehovah our best here in this time of the end. Not just to think of ourselves. If we think of ourselves, we never will give God our best. You see, Jesus had been on trial all night, back and forth, from one political leader to the next, back and forth, an illegal trial all night. Finally, they beat him, hit him on top of his head, crown made out of thorns. He's carrying his own torture stake. He passes by some women, the daughters of Jerusalem. They were crying. Jesus said, was he thinking about himself? No. What did he tell them? He said, daughters of Jerusalem, don't weep for me. You better weep for yourselves and for your children. At a time like that, he wasn't thinking about himself. He said, you better weep for yourselves and for your children. What an example. And when he was on the torture stake, remember the two criminals? He was on the torture stake. One of the criminals finally realized, said, you know, this man is far more righteous than us. He said, now, Jesus, can you remember me when you get in your kingdom? Jesus could have said, please. All of this energy, all of this strength, everything he had gone through all night. He talked to the man. He said, truly, I tell you today, you'll be with me in paradise. What an example. You see, if you think of only of yourself, you never will do what's right. You know, if you're not willing to suffer, you'll sin. If you're not willing to suffer, you'll sin. Let Jehovah work it out. Just stay in God's hands. Let him mold us. Let him direct us. And by the grace of God, we'll be able to do all that we can. And one day all of this will be over. This will all be over. We'll be in a paradise earth, living forever. We'll live as long as God lives. And we'll look back and remember, you know, I'm glad I gave Jehovah my best. So fear God. Give him glory. Because the hour of judgment by him has arrived. So worship the heavens and the earth and the sea.